great to be here in your new location. It's a very beautiful place. And may the Lord continue to watch over the church and continue to grow in His grace. I'd like to extend greetings from the church that I pastor in Livingston, Christian Evangelical Church in Livingston. It's always a joy to be here in your presence, and may the Lord continue to watch over us as we walk in this life towards eternity. Living with our Heavenly Father, who whose kingdom is in heaven above. And restricted, I was told that I should be done by about half an hour or less, so the scripture we have read already, so I try to be very detailed, but at the same time be conscious of my time as well. So let us pray. Father, this time we quiet down our hearts. Lord, we know that we are living in a chaotic world, a world full of troubles. But as always, I want to go, reminded us that we can be still because you have commanded us to be still. When things are going, seems to be going right, but we know that we are your children.
Yes.
You love us. Yes. You always watch over us. So we pray, Lord, that you will quiet down our hearts at this time as we come into your word. Yes. May your spirit will hover over this place. The people will sense your presence, and then it will be ministered to. Yes. So may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. You are a rock, our fortress, our salvation, our shelter. You are there for us in times of trouble. So may you minister to us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. The Holy Word of God teaches us that we are saved by faith in God through Jesus Christ. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. That for by grace you have been saved through faith. Mm-hmm. Not that of yourselves, it is the gift of God. And in John chapter 3, verse 15, he says that whoever believes in him, that means believes in God, should not perish but have everlasting life. Mm-hmm. In other words, when we believe in God, or when we put our faith in God, then eternal life begins. A child of God doesn't have to die first to have eternal life. Eternal life begins immediately the moment we put our faith in God. And we're looking and we are walking and taking this journey towards God's kingdom in heaven where He dwells. And in our journey on this earth, we are called to live by faith. Where this is sometimes called living faith or living by faith in God, as these terms are used interchangeably. Living faith is very closely related to sanctification. What is sanctification? It's the process or the growing to maturity in the Lord. Our living faith in God is living out our faith with our deeds and our action. We are not saved by our works. We are saved by our faith in God. But after we are saved, good works should naturally flow out from our lives. That is why James says to Christians, faith without works is dead. He puts it this way in James chapter 2, verse 17. That's also faith by itself, if it doesn't have works, is dead or without life. Once a person believes in God, it doesn't matter, and it doesn't have to end there, right? And remain stagnant or go back to our old ways of life. Rather, a believer starts to obey the teachings of the Holy Word of God by applying the biblical truth in his or her life. It is in the beginning of our exciting adventure or in a walk with God as children of God. We will be living out our faith by our good works. And if you are in your golden years or your advancing years, you said, oh, Pastor, what can I do? Because I could hardly work. That is all right. Your support and your prayers are your good works for Christ. It doesn't matter who you are, our background, our culture, our race, our gender, what stage you are at this time in your walk with the Lord. It even doesn't matter where we live. We can live out our faith in God. And when we live out our faith in God, he will reward us, which comes, may come unexpectedly, or it may even surprise us on why God would reward us for what we have done for him. So this morning we will look at the life of a person. This person was saved because she believed in God. And she lived out her faith by her good works. This person is unlikely to be the kind of person who would believe in God, needless to say, to live out her faith in God. She lived out her faith in most unlikely place. It has been hard for us to accept this person who professed to believe in God because of her occupation, the kind of profession we look down because it is considered immoral. And in Joshua chapter 2, verse 1b, in chapter 2, verse 1b, introduced to us to this person. Rahab is her name. We ask, why her? There's so many good people who are more qualified and have sterling reputation. But God would like to show us that living faith can be found in unlikely people. Joshua sent two spies to Jericho. So they, the two spies, went and entered the house of a harlot named Rahab and stayed there. Rahab was first introduced to us here. She was a woman. In the early civilization, women have no legal protection. They were abused. And she was not of Jewish race. She was a Gentile. Not of the kind of the race of the two Jewish spies. She was raised to worship idols made by human hands. She was a harlot. She had an immoral life. Her life was to be broken, messy, many flaws. For the two spies in the enemy territory, it would be hard for us to believe that there is a harlot who was willing to protect them, to harbor them, to shelter them, even lied for them to keep them alive. And the two spies found Rahab, an unlikely person, a Gentile, came to help them. My dear beloved in the Lord, how often have we tried to limit the circle of our friends? We cater only to the people we like. And we have to be careful. God is working in the lives of people, not only of our kind, but the other kind also. There are people whom we think are not Christians in their words and in their actions, and we see them as ungodly. But just later to find out that they are Christians, after all, just imperfect, messy, and weak. And they're shy. They are shy about their faith in God. And they have poor testimonies. Maybe they're going through hardship in life. Maybe they're just backslidden. We don't know. But when help is needed, this believer that we consider have lots of flaws, maybe the one who will come to our rescue. This person is there for us when help is needed. Mm-hmm. You see, there are some points in our lives that we will be discouraged. with struggles, through hardships. But someone we think is weak or weaker than us will come to encourage us. That very unlikely person. Do you have this kind of experience in your life? I have. In the ministry, few times people will speak their mind, right? We live in this culture that we speak our mind. And the words hurt. And to my surprise, a member who's often quiet and have many flaws and people don't like to come close to you, overheard what the hurtful words were spoken. And he would come to me. He said, "Pastor, can I take you out for a dinner?" Of course, I said, "Oh, it's free food, right?" So I accepted the invitation. And at the dining table, to make a long story short, he spoke words of encouragement that lifted up my spirit. This kind of words that he said. "Pastor, his words spoken would hurt me as well, and it hurt anyone. Just to let you know that I'm here for you, so keep up your good work in our church." You can see, it is hard for us to figure out. But as we live out our faith in God, there will be unlikely people who will stand alongside us. So we should believe that living faith can be found in unlikely people. After all, isn't it? We all have kind of little radar in us. We have flaws. We are broken. We have some kind of brokenness. We're weak. We're imperfect at times. We're messy, it's true. But let us be reminded that living by faith can be found in people with flaws. People we think and unlikely to have faith in God like we have. Not only living faith can be found in unlikely people, they can be found also in unlikely places. Living faith can be found in unlikely places. Joshua chapter 2, verse 2. "And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, 'Behold, men have come here tonight from the children of Israel to search out this country or to spy out this country.' The two spies were in a foreign land, Jericho. In the city of Jericho, figuring out how to get out and to return to their people. But in this unlikely place, in an enemy territory, the two spies found Rahab, a harlot who believed in God." You see, Rahab took a very big risk, right? To live out her faith in God in a very risky land. If caught for betraying her country and hiding enemy spies, she and her household could be executed. We have to remember, she lived in a land which was against the God of Israel. There may be spies eavesdropping and would report her, and he and she and her household could be arrested and be executed right there. But she wasn't afraid. She acted on her faith in God. She lived out her faith in God. She spoke to these two spies, and she basically negotiated a deal for her safety and her family members. In Joshua chapter 2, verse 8 and 14, I'll paraphrase it. "I know that the Lord has given you this land, and it's great, but the people here are very fearful. They are melting in fear because of you, because we have heard that how your God dried up the land, the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt. And now also your God has helped you defeat the two kings of the Amorites, powerful kings. And the Lord God is God in heaven above and on earth below. Now then, please swear to me by the Lord your God that you will show kindness to me and your and my family." You see, she negotiated a deal with the two spies. He said, give me a pure sign, a sure sign, that you will spare the lives of my father, my mother, my brothers and sisters, as all of those belong to me, and you will save us from death. And in Joshua 2:14, this is what the two spies said. Our lives for yours, if none of you tell this business of ours. And it shall be, when the Lord has given us the land, that we will deal kindly and truly with you. Rahab did not get a paper and say, okay, right here, yes, contract, please sign it. Right? With these words of guarantees, you believe there's two spies who have God-fearing people and will keep their words. They helped the two spies escape. She helped the two spies escape. Living faith can be found in unlikely places. My dear brothers and sisters in the Lord, how often do we feel that we are the only Christians in our workplace? In our family, in our circle of friends, it is a thief that living out our faith in this world is hard, and it's hard to find. But don't lose heart. We can be that Rahab wherever we are. We may be weak, we may have flaws, we are imperfect, but God can use you and me. In that unlikely place, our words, our behavior in public, in our workplace, in a social gathering, maybe just even watching a game of basketball, like now we have this playoff, right? Maybe playing with our friends, playing basketball. The words, that speaking the words of God in vain. Maybe it's time for us to share our faith. The usual term we hear people say, oh my God, what, right? The term, oh my God, you know, it's our starting point to share the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ. So wherever we are, whatever place we are in, let us remember that it's an opportunity for us to live out our faith, even in unlikely places. It is a time for us to defend our faith, to do good for others, to help those who need our help, to be merciful, to show mercy for those who need mercy. And because of what Rahab did, giving up her faith, she received rewards beyond what she thinks and imagines. She received unexpected gifts, rewards for living up her faith in God. Living by faith or living faith will receive unexpected rewards. My dear beloved in the Lord, the faith of Rahab in God was shown by what she did. Help two spies escape. What she did, God rewarded her beyond her wildest dream. She decided to take risk. She could keep her faith to herself. She doesn't have to take action. Just make things the way it is. Keep it the way it is. But she takes risk. Putting her life and her household in a very serious danger. And for what Rahab did, she was declared righteous before God. The passage we read a while ago says, likewise, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works? When she received the messengers and sent them off another way? When we see that word likewise, or in another translation it says in the same way, it means that we have to look at the previous verses. So this is what James chapter 2 verse 23 says. Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness, for now he's been declared right before God. And he was called a friend of God, or the friend of God. In verse 24, you see then that a man is justified by works, not by faith alone. Then move to verse 25. Likewise, or in the same way, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works? You see, Rahab was justified by her works. Rahab was declared right before God, like Abraham. She was restored to God's favor. And she must be very grateful for the gift of salvation. She must be very grateful for the reward that she received for believing in God. But not only, she has now become a child of God. She received another reward. She and her household were saved from destruction. In Joshua chapter 6, verse 23, it tells us that she and her household, her father, her mother, her sisters, her brothers, and all who belonged to her, her relatives, were all rescued and brought out of the city before it was destroyed. Her household was able also to take out their belongings out of Jericho. So she and her household were saved from destruction. And third, the blessing doesn't end here. She and her household live among God's people. Verse 25, Joshua chapter 6. She and her household were accepted and added to the nation of Israel. She and her household now belong to the people of God. To her, and maybe to us, it is good that we are spared, right? And live in peace and safety. But God doesn't stop here to reward the Rahab. She received another reward by living out her faith in God. Fourth, she was in the lineage of Christ. I'm using the NIV translation here for easier understanding. He says in Matthew chapter 1, verse 5, Simon, there's a name of a person, a name of a fish, Simon, the father of Boaz, whose mother was who? Rahab. Okay? Simon and Rahab, they had Boaz. And Boaz, the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. So Boaz and Ruth together, they had Obed. Obed, the father of Jesse. Very good. And Jesse, the father of King David. And the genealogy continues. And then we get to verse 16. And Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, who was born Jesus, who is called Christ. You see, there are many even scholars and theologians, conservative ones, who believe that there's a high possibility that Solomon was one of the two spies. You see, Rahab doesn't have to go to Ill Harmony to look for her mate. God provided her with husband Solomon as a reward for living out her faith in God. Fifth, she was among the heroes of faith. Hebrews 11, verse 31. Another reward came to her for living out her faith in God. In the hall of heroes in heaven, and all in the halls of fame in heaven, there were two women specifically mentioned. One is Sarah, the wife of Abraham, and the second one is Ruth. The book of Hebrews, chapter 11, gives us the name of the heroes of faith. In verse 31, it says, "By faith, the harlot Rahab did not perish with those who did not believe, when she had received the spies with peace." Please look, and please think very carefully. God did not bring up the issue that she lied to save God's people. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Amazing. Mm-hmm. Not that it's okay, it's not the right to lie, okay? Don't get me wrong, all right? It's not the right to lie, but God did not bring it up. It is because when we believe in God, through Jesus, Christ covered all our sins, and we have been declared righteous before the eyes of God, and we are declared right before God. You may say, oh, not me. No, you are declared righteous. In spite of our imperfection, in spite of our weaknesses, because God, Christ died for us. We're covered by the blood of Christ. That's why Prophet Isaiah, in Isaiah 1 verse 18, says, though your sins are as red as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they're red like crimson, they shall be as white. They shall be as wool. You see, this reminds us always that even we are imperfect, God would like to use us. And you will notice that also in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, the word harlot was brought up. Just because the author just would like us to know that we must not confuse her with some other Rahab who had sterling reputation. God would like us to make sure that we don't think of other Rahab. It is that this Rahab the harlot. This is exactly Rahab the harlot who made it to the halls of heroes in heaven. Therefore, my dear beloved, you know what? The God of Rahab is the same God that we believe in. He has chosen us, people with flaws, broken, weak, imperfect, and maybe messy. But he likes to work with people like us, just like he did with Rahab. And the God who rewarded Rahab for living out her faith is the same God who will reward us when we live up our faith in him. Like hey, Rahab, we don't have to wait till we get to heaven to enjoy earthly rewards. We can have rewards here on this earth. So, I don't know what kind of rewards God will give you. He has rewarded me many things, but my time is almost up. There are so many things that God has blessed me with. And he will do the same to you as well. Be faithful to him. Live up your faith. God who rewarded Rahab will reward you as well. I can only say that what rewards that you will receive from God will be beyond what you think and imagine. So be encouraged in your Christian journey. Together, let us keep believing in him. Together, let us keep doing what is good in the eyes of God until we see our Lord Jesus Christ face to face. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you again for your word. That it may minister to me personally, and we pray, Lord, that as your truth is communicated to your people, that you will be blessed as well. We pray, Lord, that this truth that we have learned today will hold into our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Y'all blessed by that preaching by Pastor Stephen.
Amen.
Yeah. God is faithful, and with his faithfulness that, you know,